Survival of the fittest. It's really not something that just applies to our planet, but likely applies to every species potentially located in our universe. And if you think we're alone in our universe, I would implore you to kind of like take a look at how big the freaking universe is. There's just no way. Anyhow, what lengths would an individual group go to, and what were they willing to sacrifice into the furnace to stay in power? Well, in Doom Eternal, we actually figure out that aliens are just total dicks with wings. Throwing down the gauntlet of power on humanity, not only did they likely influence our whole perception of God and heaven for the Homo sapiens, but they also unleashed the demonic horde on Earth, as well as many other planets, under the guise of actually being helpful. Well, technically they were helpful for a time, but would ultimately turn on the species that helped them, like the Night Sentinels, or didn't help at all, like with the humans. All to keep the power that they had become accustomed to. However, this desire for power would go on to corrupt their species under their rule, and eventually corrupt the Maykrs themselves, whether they knew it or not. In the events leading up to the Conmaker's untimely end, her own species would have been corrupted like any other. So today, it's pretty clear what we know what we're talking about if you saw the title and literally the thumbnail. The Whiplash from Doom Eternal and its origins as well as morphology. So let's get to it, shall we? But before we start, something I did want to mention is someone said I should advertise my fourth channel a little more. So I basically have one where I just kind of read horror stories and whatnot. I'll link it in the description if anybody is interested. I'm still kind of figuring out how to read them better. So kind of bear with me on that front. On Earth, when the Slayer arrived, it was all-out war with humans fighting demons but constantly being knocked back on their heels. No massive mechs, no amount of firepower, nothing but the literal unstoppable deadliness of Australia could hold these things off. I know I've made that joke before, but seriously, what is going on down there? With the cities in ruins and only small outposts even remotely holding off the smallest numbers of demons, these would quickly be run over in the future when more portals were allowed to open up, and then the demons could go on and just ransack the area. Being the Slayer, you would like to put a stop to the suffering of your people, and then begin taking out Hell Priests where you may. This requires you to travel all over the planet, which again, you're using portals so it doesn't really take that long. When you head way north into the icy depths of the Arctic, the area houses the cultist base. Seeing as the Hell Priest is currently located there, the demonic presence is quite thick, and as with the rest of Earth, the Slayer's got quite a fight to get through. Dropping into one particular area after taking the elevator to open the door to the base, however, you're met with a creature who slithers across the ground and throws hell energy at you. This particular being doesn't appear to be like any of the others. Instead, it moves like a serpent and looks like one too. However, after closer inspection, its legs are gone and it seems to be enhanced cybernetically as well as wearing physical armor. Fighting this creature shows it's much faster than your average demon and has the agility to match, but that hardly makes it invincible. To a normal soldier, this creature would be a fairly difficult animal to keep pace with, and likely your upper body would be sliding off your lower body before you even knew what happened as the energetic waves that it throws around hit you. Regardless, taking this thing out is more of a task than you might imagine. Because of the fact it can move and also seems to want to preserve itself more than normal, it makes it a much harder target to hit. Slithering across the ground, it rapidly changes pace and direction, which makes it difficult for even the Slayer to keep track of. However, getting a good look at it, it should remind you of something. But before getting there, let's take a look at its overall physiology and determine what it is and what it might have come from. Starting with the tail, this creature is clearly a cybernetically enhanced demon. In fact, most demons appear to be a blending of technology and flesh. A lot of them can still be, you know, sort of using their original meat suits, which has been influenced by the demonic energy, but this creature in particular has a union of all three. Imagine it to basically be like the carcass demon, who was clearly a fallen soldier bisected in combat. It can be assumed that this creature likely at some point lost the legs that it possessed, or even more likely, it never had them to begin with, which we will cover further on in the video when we discuss its origins. Anyhow, this long tail is absolutely not a weak point though. Resisting pretty much anything that you can throw at it, the only real way to stop this thing is to damage the organic body enough to put an end to it. This is not to say, however, the tail is completely mechanical. It can be seen that when you attack this thing and slice it apart, you can break through the mechanical covering of the tail to get to the fleshy, gooey goodness that lies underneath. Moving further up, we can see that there is no pelvis on this creature, because it likely never existed in the first place, and instead, much like a snake, it's just kind of a long stomach. Something to note as we move up the abdomen is the stringy muscle on either side and the way the rib cage is structured. The abdominal muscles appear to be much more striated than, say, like a human's abdominal muscles, and this type of striation allows for something known as rectilinear locomotion, which is the most common movement of snakes in a forward motion. The ribs on either side of the body not being joined to the front like a human's would also indicate that this creature may have never had legs to begin with, but instead is much like that of a serpent in the sense that the rib cage runs fairly far down to provide the connection points necessary for the striated muscle to move this creature. The striated muscle may be a little tough to see because of the red tubes housing the energy, but likely based on body structuring, they would be as described. The abdominal muscles themselves are covered with mostly a portion of the armored tail. Running all the way up to the chest, we can see a few indications that the skeleton has been fused on, or at least onto, so that it properly anchored onto the body. And we can see at the center, the main anchoring would be applied directly to the sternum. Based on the chest's appearance, this creature would in fact likely have a sternum, which would fuse the ribs of the upper portion, allowing it to be structured the way we see, and actually have a literal upper body, which could support the shoulder girdle like we humans enjoy. This shoulder girdle allows for the pectoral muscles to form, much like ours, as well as the arms and trapezius muscles. And speaking of arms, moving down to those, we can see that this creature is not some massively strong beast capable of ripping apart humans, but instead likely, if you got into hand-to-hand combat with this thing, you might actually be able to keep all your limbs attached, if it was in its sort of unarmored form and didn't have any offensive capability. Because moving further down the arms, we can see that these black gloves appear around mid-bicep to tricep, and likely this is armor. But moving down to the hands, there are several large claws that can be used for slashing, meaning that this thing could likely still take off a few of your limbs. This creature has 3 fingers in total, with a pointer finger being much longer than the thumb and third finger. The gauntlets themselves show that this creature has some bony growths forming in the forearms, which, just like any other demon, means that the bones are growing. But it also has daggers that it can hold that can be also extended to form a whip. This whip controls the hell energy likely from the cybernetic suit it wears and can be projected out into a wave to slice apart anything except for the Doomslayer. Moving around to the back of this creature, we see that it has been malformed, much like every other creature infected with hell energy, which is very unsurprising. The spine has been increased in size, giving it a hunch, but this has also had the added effect of causing the creature to have sort of a forward head posturing. The spine now appears to be attached to the back of the skull instead of the front. This may have had a few effects, which let's discuss those real quick. Getting a good look at the head, the jaw, like any other forms of demons, have been damaged to have larger teeth, and has become almost split down the middle, suggesting that the growth of the mandible put pressure on it at that point. Jagged teeth now sit almost at random, and the canines appear much larger in size. Large ridges can be seen on the cheekbones of this creature, which we'll connect later, and the eyes glow a dull red. But there does appear to be some skin left over at the bottom of the eyes. The nose is non-existent, as in like a human form, but instead is really just a hole in the face with 4 openings. And it's interesting because humans only have 2, which makes you wonder what the purpose of the 4 openings is. Horns sit on the top of the head with the brain completely exposed, and wiring can be seen out the back of the head, coming out from the brain and connecting from the inside of the body to the suit. So, getting back to the whole connection point, there is this thing with, like, you know, how the spine is connected to the skull. So for instance, chimps have their spine connected to the back of their skulls, and as a result, this puts strain on the neck muscles. Due to more strain being on the neck, the head can only be so heavy before it's too much for the body to keep up. Coupled with this, the connection points of the muscle to the skull has to be beefier. This in turn takes up more space on the skull, leaving less space for the brain. Along with the masticating jaw muscles, these all come together to form a creature that is relatively smart, but will never be as smart as a human because of spine location. Humans, on the other hand, we sort of have our spines connect to the base of the skull. The skull is supported by bone rather than by muscle, and because of this, our brains were allowed to grow. And then over time, after this initial push, likely led to our brains becoming more efficient and intelligent. Then, because of our increased intelligence, we learned how to cook food, and as a result of this, we actually got a newfound processing power which made our jaws even smaller, which allowed for our brain to grow even larger after that. So the moral of this story is, spine under, big brain hours. Spine behind, small brainlets. Taking the whiplash, we can see that this creature's brain may be smaller as a result of the changes that we see in the structuring of the body. And I can hear you over the screen now. Roanoke, what in God's name are you talking about? How can you draw that comparison when we don't even know what the original form was? Well, look no further than the species of origin, of course. This thing isn't just some random demon from some unknown planet and species. It's actually a Maykr. In fact, as confirmed, it's female as well, which is critical for why we see this creature as is. So the Maykr society is actually sort of a hive, which explains the drones that we see later on in the game. It would appear that the Maykr species not only had to sacrifice every other species to maintain the power it currently had, but would also throw its own kind into the meat grinder as their corruption deepened and became more apparent. So here's what I believe is going on with the Whiplash in relation to all of this. First, take a look at the lack of legs. Is this because of the fact that it was bisected, or because it never had them originally? It's definitely the latter over the former. Looking at the drones, which are the male counterpart to the Whiplash, just not infested with hell energy, they're said to be relatively immature and cannot currently deal with the damage done by portal traveling. So they stay at home base, essentially. We see that they have no legs to speak of, and instead have tentacles coming out of their body. There are no arms to speak of, which may indicate that their arms grow later in life, because we can assume this based on their armor literally having armholes. And seeing as the Whiplash is female and has arms, this may mean that the males get theirs later. Next, I would like to point out the hands. Looking at the con maker, who is clearly female, she has three fingers in total. A long pointer, a thumb, and then a third finger. The Whiplash are the exact same. Three fingers and even more slender structuring is also the same. But the biggest comparison I would like to make between the con maker and the Whiplash is the face. When you knock off the con maker's helmet, it reveals that, holy lord, she is ugly. The teeth are pointed and jagged, much like that of the Whiplash. The nose is missing, again, like the Whiplash. However, looking at the cheekbones, we can see how clearly and easily they could be compared and presumed to be similar. The eyes are also similar, and even though demons do have these standard glowing eyes which can be seen on the Whiplash, it's certainly undeniable that they do look the same. But then getting up to the brain, it's actually big brain hours. And this is why I suggest that spine placement is crucial. Con Maykr likely has a larger brain, not just because of the birthright, but her brain proportions are larger than that of the Whiplash. All these point to the fact that the Whiplash is in fact a Maykr, but one that was likely betrayed. The Maykr species does appear to have biological autonomy, meaning that they can do their own thing and make their own choices, seeing as they were a fairly intelligent species. However, they cannot deny the will of the Con Maykr, and as a result, follow her rules and do her bidding. It would seem that the females in particular prior to the hell energy usage would have likely existed in a society where there was one leader, which was the Con Maykr, but after the corruption, the drones, which are the males, are kept by the Con Maykr for reasons, and the females were sent to be used into the furnace for energy, which gives us the Whiplash Demon. After sacrificing her own people, she would go on to use other species for the same power she craved, which is why you had to punch her in the face as the Doomslayer. So what's the best way to take this thing out? Well, the Doomslayer likes to kind of use a less is more strategy. Why waste ammo when there's a perfectly good skeleton within the creature that you can just stab into its brain? Apart from that, either destroy the brain or remove the head. The Doomslayer will typically go for this strategy, but the most brutal would have to be slicing it into three pieces. And again, we can actually see under the tail armor, there is in fact a body. But the creature is sliced into multiple parts, ensuring it will likely never be pieced back together again. And if you were just your average human and, say, didn't have, like, the armor of the Slayer, likely this creature's whip could completely bisect a human with little to no issue or cut off a limb, which would lead to a quick bleed out. I did want to point out something kind of cool, however. As I'm writing this script, it's interesting how rooted in religion this game is. The serpents being quite prevalent, and on top of that, a female leading to the downfall of a species, sort of like Adam and Eve in a serpent sort of deal. I don't know, I just find it pretty cool. If you look hard enough into this game, it's all there, but never referenced once, and definitely isn't laid on too thick. That's why I say Doom Eternal's pretty, dare I say, iconic.